Good morning friends, I'm Srishti and today we will be covering 5 questions of finance. Today's questions are more of the conceptual based ones, so you need to pay the attention till the end of the video so to have a basic understanding of these questions. If you haven't subscribed to our channel, then hit the bell icon for regular updates. Now starting with the first question without wasting any time. So question says, during the time when India is performing well in the international markets, rupee has seen consistent appreciation. Mr. A, an Indian resident wants to buy an imported watch from America. Is this the correct time for him to purchase? So 4 options are there: yes, no, economic scenario of a country does not affect the purchasing decisions, and the last one is incomplete information has been provided. So let's have a basic understanding of this. Now while reading the question, you must have guessed that this question relates to the exchange rate one. And I have taken this question because many of you were facing the problem in the exchange rate concept. So in the next slide, we will be doing it. Now, suppose $1 is equals to rupees 50 earlier. And when the economic times were not good, rupee depreciated and now the exchange rate is $1 is equals to rupees 100. Now see, earlier when it was rupees 50 is equals to $1, you could either purchase the same good in US for rupees 50, and now you will be able to purchase the same good in US worth rupees 100. So in this case, imports will be expensive. And if we talk about the exports, then if you were exporting a watch earlier, you were getting rupees 50. If we assume the watch to be of $1 for your understanding. But now, after the depreciation, for the same watch exported and for the same price, that is $1, you are able to get rupees 100. So now, are you getting it that when the rupee depreciates, it is a good time to export and imports become expensive, as we have already seen, and exports become beneficial as you are getting more money just because of the rupee depreciation without changing the price of your product. The next one is when rupee appreciates. So suppose earlier it was $1 is equals to rupees 100, and now after the appreciation it turned out to be rupees 50. So when the rupee has appreciated, earlier you were buying a watch from America worth rupees 100. You have to pay off rupees 100 to get $1, and suppose that watch is for $1. So ultimately you are giving off 100 rupees from your pocket. But now after the rupee appreciation, you just have to give rupees 50 to buy that same watch of $1. So in rupee appreciation times, it is a good time to import as it becomes cheaper. Now I hope that you have understood this concept of rupee appreciation, depreciation and the good times to export and import. Now let's move back to the question to answer it. So Mr. A has imported a watch from America when rupee has seen consistent appreciation. So is this the correct time for him to purchase? So yes, this is the correct time because now imports have become cheaper and he could purchase the same watch by spending lesser rupees. Now moving on to the next question for today. Okay, so which of the following is not an assumption in the Miller and Modigliani approach? So you must have read MM approach in capital structure in the financial management. So this is one of the very important theories of capital structure. So there are 6 assumptions of MM approach which we are going to discuss now, and a little more explanation of the MM approach in the next slide. So the first assumption is that the capital markets are perfect and complete information is available to all the investors free of cost. The second is that there are no transaction costs. Third is that the securities are infinitely divisible. Fourth is that investors are rational, well informed about the risk return of all the securities. Fifth is when the investors have same probability distribution about the expected future earnings. And the last is that there is no corporate income tax. However, this assumption was relaxed later, which we are going to discuss the proposition with taxes in the next slide. But initially, if we talk about the assumptions, then these were the assumptions here. So now let's look at the options. There are no transaction costs. This is correct. Securities are infinitely divisible. This is also correct. Investors have homogeneous expectations. So as I have told you that the markets are perfect, complete information is available. So by perfect market, it implies that the investors have homogeneous expectations. The fourth is that all the firms pay taxes on their income at the same rate. So this is not the correct one, and therefore our answer is option D. Now let's discuss this theory in the next slide. So MM approach is classified in two things, that proposition without tax and proposition with tax. So here there are two propositions, proposition 1, proposition 2. The first one says that the capital structure, it does not influence the value of the firm. That is, debt holders and equity shareholders have the same priority. The second proposition says that financial leverage is in direct proportion of the cost of equity. So we determine KE in terms of, that is, three factors on which the KE depends are overall cost of equity, we say it as KO, then cost of debt, and the firm's debt equity ratio. Now, proposition with taxes. So here it assumes that there is the existence of taxes. As I've already told you that initially corporate tax assumption was there, that there are no corporate taxes, but later on it was relaxed. So here it is realized that there is existence of taxes. Therefore, the tax benefits due to interest payments are recognized, because we know that interest payments on the debt is tax deductible, and we have already discussed this in the earlier videos. So it basically implies that the cost of debt reduces by the interest tax shields. So therefore, a change in the debt component affects the value of the firm. So these are the two propositions with regard to the MM approach. In the proposition one here, there is a famous thing that MM introduced, was the arbitrage process. So through this approach, he proves that the value of the levered firm and the value of unlevered firm are the same. So therefore, he proves that there is no effect of the capital structure on the value of the firm. So now, after discussing the brief idea of the MM approach, let's move on to the next question for today. And if you feel that something more have to be discussed in relation to the arbitrage process, then you must comment in the comment section. As of now, I am not covering the arbitrage process, because from your exam point of view, the arbitrage process is not so important. Just a brief idea will work in your examination. The next question is, a firm should stop its production the moment when? So out of the four options, you have to tell me. So if a firm is running a factory and that factory is on rent, so when should a firm stop its production? When it is unable to cover its fixed cost, when it is unable to cover its variable cost, when it is unable to cover its fixed or the variable cost, or when it is unable to meet its target of sale. So let's understand this. So if you are running a factory which is on rent, and if you are unable to cover your variable cost, so that is the moment when you should stop your production or you should shut down the factory. Because if you shut down your factory, anyway you are unable to cover your fixed cost. So till the time you are able to cover your variable cost, it acts as a compensator for your fixed cost, and your total loss will therefore be less. For example, if the amount of rent, that is your fixed cost, is 1 lakh rupees, and by realizing some of your variable cost, you are able to make this loss of 1 lakh to a lower amount. But if you shut down your factory, even if you are able to cover up your variable cost, then anyway your loss will be of 1 lakh rupees, and it will not get compensated by any of your earnings. So therefore, the answer is, it is unable to cover its variable cost, that is option number B. Now you might question that why not when it is unable to meet its target of sales, because this is not a serious thing. This might be improved by the marketing techniques or the increasing the productivity. So this is not a point when you should shut down your factory. Now let's move on to the next question for today, which is very important. XYZ Bank declares Mr. A as doubtful asset while analyzing its balance sheet. Which of the following are the conditions for doubtful assets as per the guidelines of RBI with effect from 31st March 2005? So let's discuss this question of NPA asset classification. So if there is a borrower, say A, and he has taken a loan from a bank XYZ in our case. So what are the rules now if he is unable to repay back or if he defaults on the interest payment? So let's discuss it. So if Mr. A fails to pay any of the interest payments on the loan, then the lender shall recognize this stress in loan accounts immediately on default by classifying such assets as the special mention accounts as per the following categories. So this is SMA 0, SMA 1 and SMA 2. So these are the categories of SMA, and what are the basis for classification? This is 1 to 30 days, this is 31 to 60 days, and this is 61 to 90 days. And we know that after the 90 days, such an asset will be known as NPA. Now further, there is the asset classification for NPA, that is the substandard asset, doubtful asset and the loss asset. So with effect from 31st March 2005, a substandard asset would be one which has remained NPA for a period less than or equal to 12 months. Doubtful asset is the one where an asset would be classified as doubtful if it has remained in the substandard category for a period of 12 months. And lastly, the loss assets are the one. Loss has been identified by the bank or internal or external auditors or the RBI inspection, but the amount has not been written off wholly. That is, an asset is considered uncollectible and of such little value that its continuance as a bankable asset is not warranted, although there may be some salvage or the recovery value. Now, after discussing this asset classification for NPAs, I would like to discuss a recent change here. So earlier what happened was that lenders had to start the resolution even if there was a one-day default. But the new NPA resolution norms replaced the previous model, and the central bank said that under the new norms, defaults are to be recognized within 30 days. And why this review period of 30 days is given? Because the purpose is that if there is any default of this Mr. A with any of the lender, then it is an indicator that Mr. A is facing financial problems. So it is expected that the lenders initiate the process of implementing a resolution plan even before a default. For example, if A has taken a loan from XYZ, also it has taken a loan from ABC, and if he defaults on the loan taken from ABC but not yet on the loan taken from XYZ, so XYZ should take the 30 days review period from such default, that is here it has made the default. So from such default, 30 days review period will be there, and during this review period of 30 days, lenders may decide on the resolution strategy, including the nature of the resolution plan or the approach for implementation, etc. And the board shall approve the policies for the resolution of stressed assets. Now, in cases where the resolution plan is to be implemented, then all the lenders, that is ABC, XYZ and any other bank from where A has taken the loan, then all lenders shall enter into an inter-creditor agreement during the 30 days review period. So the basic aim is that even if A has not defaulted on the loans taken from XYZ, then also it has to play safe and it has to check that whether A has defaulted on any other loans taken from any other lender. So after understanding this basic concept of NPA, let's move back to the question. So the answer here is Mr. A has remained in the category of substandard asset for a period of 12 months as we have already discussed it. Now moving on to the last question for today. The rate at which RBI lends short-term money to the banks by purchasing the government securities under a repurchase agreement, then what it is called? Now discussing these one by one, repo rate means it is a rate at which the central bank lends money to the commercial banks. So it is basically used by central bank to keep inflation under control. So when a commercial bank sells the security to central bank to raise money, then the banks promises to buy back the same security from the central bank at a predetermined rate with an interest at the rate of repo. And it is actually a repurchase agreement. So as per the question, our answer is option number A, that is repo rate. Now discussing further, what is reverse repo rate? When the commercial bank lends money to the central bank, the bank rate is, so it is a rate of interest which a central bank charges on the loans and advances to a commercial bank without selling or buying any security. So what is open market operations? It consists of buying or selling of government securities to influence the money supply in the economy. So as per the recent cut in the repo rate, the new rates are, repo rate is at 5.15%, reverse repo rate is at 4.90%, bank rate is at 5.4%. So I hope that you have understood the concept that I have told you regarding the repo, reverse repo and the bank rate. So students often get confused between the repo rate and the bank rate. Now with this, we have completed 5 questions for today. I hope that you have liked this session. And if you like the video, then do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. Thank you for watching the video.